Hello, my name is Conrad Beard Obey, and unfortunately, this is my real voice. I'm going to be presenting this video about a trip I took in early 2015 in Murchison Falls in Uganda. I'll give you what few tips I can about making such a trip as I go along. Starting with using a handycam with a good zoom. Mine had like a 700X. So that you can see recognizable animals like this. Otherwise, you'll see only little tiny dots on the horizon like this. Bribing the guards will allow you to get very close to the animals, like in these shots. But remember, these are wild animals, so do be cautious. Alright, just kidding. Those animals are completely tame. Okay, seriously. These shots are photoshopped. This one is the real shot from which the others are derived. And no other shots have been faked. Prior to video segments, I'll start off with a few slides, like those of this marabou stork, the lapwing, guinea fowl, hornbill, and fish eagle, which will segue into video segments of the related creatures. And this video is about a half an hour long, so I'll put time/chapter marks in the description for this video. So if you want to skip over any of the animals to jump to your favorites, you can do that. I'll just give you a little bit of background about my trip. The fellow with whom I was supposed to go on safari with, David Prentice, a prominent amateur mountaineer who was very active in the Ugandan ecotourism scene, particularly in promoting ecotourism in the Mount Elgon area, passed away while I was doing some work in Uganda. And after all the rigmarole associated with that tragedy were finally arranged, I still had a few days off to de-stress from that ordeal and to thereafter continue with the beekeeping training that I was involved in. And I've put together many beekeeping training in Africa videos. If you're interested in that, you can take a look for them. So, because I was doing volunteer work, I didn't have a huge budget for extraneous travel recreation. I wound up hiring a private guide whose name was Mahamadou Kirikarama in the town of Masindi. And I wound up spending about $500 US over the course of 2 days, roughly two-thirds of which went to Mahamadou and the other third went to paying park entrance fees. Food and tent space for my own tent that I had with me at the Red Chili Rest Camp were less than $20, real cheap. If you were to stay at one of the lodges in the park with one of their guided safaris, you could wind up spending thousands, if not tens of thousands of dollars for a few days of travel. I had a great time, and I certainly think the money was well spent, and even if you're on the $10,000 plan, I think that you're going to find your experience well worth the price. I had exceptionally good luck on the game drives and the river cruise that I was on in seeing a huge variety of wildlife, and I would totally recommend the experience. Another travel tip, the guide I found in Masindi, or actually, he found me, being an unknown, gave me some misgivings, particularly when he wanted half of his fee up front. But he suggested that I keep his passport, which I photographed and emailed to my folks back home, just in case I was never seen again, they'd have some something to go on. But Mahamadou Kirikarama turned out to be a great guy and didn't have any problems. And gave him his passport with the final payment after our trip was done. On another finance-related note, park fees were required to be paid in U.S. dollars. And oddly, they wouldn't take old bills either at the park nor at the campgrounds for food. So in addition to wearing a money belt or taking whatever other security precautions you are accustomed to, you should also make sure that you have a good supply of quality US dollars. Now, if you've been curious about the names of all of the bird life that have been playing in the video, I will put the names and scientific names to the best of my identification abilities in the descriptor for the video with the time marks. Here we're seeing the top of Murchison Falls from the trail. There's a couple of folks that I took a cruise with. That's Matan, an Israeli on the left there, and Alex, a German, on the right. They were both on the river cruise I took, which ends with a walking tour up to the top of the falls. Alright, let me talk a little bit about some of the animals I saw. This is a Nile crocodile. They can reach a length of up to 30 feet, and they seem quite willing to feed on just about any animal that they can acquire in their watery habitat, including humans, eating as many as 200 humans in Africa per year. If you search on YouTube, you can find crocodiles attacking everything from elephants to giraffes to water bucks to hart beasts, as well as antelope, warthogs, water buffalo, and baboons. Smaller creatures, such as the ground squirrel and the mongoose, probably escape the attention of the crocodile. What was that for a strange segue? Of the African ground squirrels, this looks most to me like the Cape ground squirrel, but it's not supposed to get as far north as Uganda, so I don't know. I only saw these critters from far, far away. They are mongooses. Not to be confused with mongoose, which is not the appropriate plural. I looked it up. Mongooses feed on insects, earthworms, small rodents, and even eggs. And, as their appearance may indicate, they are closely related to meerkats. Waterbuck, as their name would indicate, tend to frequent the marshier or boggier areas of savannas. Only the males have horns with which they protect the harems they maintain from other males. In case you've ever wondered, horns and antlers differ in that antlers are made of bony tissue that is shed every year, whereas horns are made out of bony tissue surrounded by keratin, which is the same protein from which hair and fingernails are made. The oribi is a smallish antelope, very similar to the gazelle. Again, only the males have horns, so this is a female. As do many other mammalian species, the males of the oribi will mark their territory using urine. In addition, if you can catch it under their ears, you'll see a black round gland, which produces pheromones, which are also used by the males to mark their territory. There it is, you can see it there. See that black brown spot underneath the ear and behind the eye? That's the gland. I didn't get any shots of it, but the oribi and other antelopes will engage in a behavior called stoting, or pronging, or pronking, where they bounce up into the air with their legs very stiff. This is most likely a display of fitness indicating to the opposite sex its desirability as a mate, and to potential predators as to its undesirability as prey. The cob is a larger species of antelope, very handsome, and much like the oribi, prefers the same type of rolling terrain and grasslands that are highly desirable for agriculture. And so these antelope species are in competition with humans for preferred habitat. Male cobs will mark their territory by producing a whistling sound. Hartbeests are yet another type of antelope, very similar in appearance, to my mind, to the wildebeest, or gnu. The males, at times of year, will very vigorously defend their territory, and if you want to see an example of that, Google hartbeest versus bicycle, and you'll find a video of that very dynamic. Hartbeests are very swift runners and have excellent stamina. It is these characteristics that account for its name, hartbeest, which means in Afrikaner, tough ox. Warthogs have the unusual habit of grazing frequently from a kneeling position. That was when they were kneeling. Ah, there's one. Kind of a downward dog kind of position. Warthogs will often use abandoned aardvark dens to escape from perceived threats and to rear their young. The Cape or African buffalo, although superficially similar, is a different species to the domesticated Asian water buffalo, and it is an entirely different genus than the American bison, which is often referred to as the buffalo. Males, in particular, can be dangerous as they are unpredictable and may attack with little provocation. They seem to enjoy wading or wallowing in water and, in fact, are not found in areas that have less than 10 inches of rain per year. Water buffalo, like other ruminants, have four stomachs, and after partial processing in the first stomach, forage is regurgitated as cud that is chewed and then passed on to the lower stomachs, where digestion is facilitated by a suite of microbes with which the buffaloes have a symbiotic relationship. The colobus monkey has a very handsome pelt that at one time was used to make dance costumes and hats. After having had my beard trimmed in a barbershop in Uganda, I was surprised and somewhat chagrined to find the barber brushing debris off my face with the preserved tail of a colobus monkey. Vervet monkeys are a much more common species than the colobus, and more or less like raccoons in their habits. They can survive in some urban environments and can be significant agricultural pests, since they will eat most of the same fruits and vegetables that humans enjoy. They have been introduced to the Caribbean Isles of St. Kitts and Barbados. Because of the verdant tinge to their fur, they are sometimes called the green vervet. This is the result of genetic engineering, which attempted to incorporate chlorophyll into the fur of the monkey in an attempt to create a solar-powered primate. The project hoped to eventually create photosynthetic humans and thus curb world hunger. Nah. The slightly greenish K cast is probably just the result of the combination of black, white, and yellow pigments in the animal's fur. Here's a joke I just made up. What do you call a monkey with a lit stick of dynamite? A baboon! Okay, sorry, but baboons kind of creep me out, so I thought I'd lighten the moment. Baboons have an even wider dietary preference than the vervets. They'll eat everything from tubers and barks and leaves to vegetables and fruits, and even animal proteins such as fish, shellfish, and even lesser mammals such as hares, small antelopes, and even vervets. I saw some of the biggest baboons I've ever seen in Uganda, but unfortunately I wasn't able to get any good shots of any of the really large males. Well, monkey butts. I might as well say something about them since they're fairly distinctive, and this dude's scratching his. The baboon's hindquarters are covered with hairless, calloused skin, which allows them to sit comfortably for hours, feeding, as this one is doing. Baboons seem to be most active during the cooler parts of the day, right around dawn and towards dusk. I've long believed that garbled observations of baboons, or garbled tales thereof, resulted in the accounts of dog-headed men, frequently mentioned by ancient travelers from Greek literature through medieval European travel logs. If I had kids who wouldn't eat their breakfast gruel, I'd tell them this. If o'er one bowl of oatmeal you fuss, beware the hippo pot of mush. Yeah, that's why I'm making YouTube videos instead of writing poetry. I doubt that there are really good statistics on this, but I've read in several places that hippos in Africa kill more people every year than do crocodiles. As funny looking as the creatures look, they can be quite ferocious when defending their territory. The victims of hippo attacks are largely rural women who are doing laundry at the water's edge. The reddish tinge that you see on the skin of hippos is due to a glandular secretion that acts as a moisturizer and sunblock. The appearance of these incarnadine droplets led to the false belief that hippos sweated blood. The word hippopotamus comes from the Greek, meaning river horse. So if you hear the word hippodrome, that refers to a horse racing course and has nothing to do with the African animals. Water and mud help to keep the hippo's body cool during the heat of the day, and they will generally only be seen at any considerable distance away from water during the night. Although they may appear ungainly, hippos, over short distances, can run for speeds of up to nearly 20 miles per hour, so you would be hard-pressed to outrun one if you were attacked. Their sharp tusks, useful in dealing with the tough aquatic plants and grasses on which they feed, can also inflict horrendous injuries. Alright, here's something I reworked from Patrick Winstanley. I once told a woman, whom I once dated, the hippo's a horse, just overinflated. To me, the hippo, she then rejoined, is much like a rhino, albeit quite pointless. Couldn't figure out what the dog-like running creature in this next segment was until I returned home and took a look at the videos in slow motion. Turns out it is the side-striped jackal, which is in fact in the dog family. And even in slow motion, it greatly resembles the coyote in both appearance and habits. Also somewhat dog-like in appearance is the spotted hyena. However, although also falling within the order Carnivora, the spotted hyena is more closely allied with felines, with the cats, than it is with canines, dogs. Spotted hyenas live in groups of up to 80 individuals that are referred to as clans. One of the more interesting things about spotted hyena biology is that the social order is controlled by the females. And, as in most social hierarchies in the animal kingdom, perhaps in the human as well, social dominance is established by aggression. The female genitalia of hyenas is very similar to that of the males, possessing, as they do, a pseudo-penis. This complicates both copulation and the birthing process. From 10 to 20% of spotted hyena females die while giving birth to their first litter of kits. Those that survive lose about 60% of their firstborn young. Physiologically, the formation of the tissue forming the pseudopenis is probably due to high titer of male hormones to which developing hyena fetuses are exposed in utero. The high levels of male hormone in the females is thought to be responsible for the aggression they exhibit. Spotted hyenas can grow to as large as 90 pounds and have jaws that are strong enough to crack the large bones of animals left at the kill sites of other predators. The ability to access the rich marrow within these bones is one that is not shared with many other predator species. It is likely, then, that hyenas represented one of the chief competitors with our early hominid ancestors, who were also able to access this rich marrow food resource by cracking into bones with stone tools.
The hyena might laugh at the thought a giraffe could mate with a gnat, the result being that, and this really riches, their kids all hatched out, one and all, as ostriches. Really, the theory is fraught with some hitches. How the mating could happen just leaves one in stitches.
Odd as it may sound, a couple of thousand years ago in classical Rome, before the rules of heredity were well understood, the Roman historian Pliny suggested that the ostrich might be the result of a cross between a gnat and a giraffe. The giraffe itself, as indicated by its scientific binomial, Giraffa camelopardalis, was thought to have been produced by crossing a camel with a leopard. That's the kind of warped thinking that led to that whole Pokemon thing. Anyway, as long as the giraffe's neck is, it's too short to reach the ground. So in order to drink, it has to splay its front legs out awkwardly or kneel down, which makes it quite vulnerable to predators. Luckily, it gets most of its water requirements from the plants that it eats, so it only needs to drink every couple of days. Since the giraffe's legs are about 2 meters, or 6 feet long, and they give birth standing up, the newborn giraffe falls about 5 feet to the ground at birth. Those long legs and the dinner plate-sized feet in which they end allow the giraffe to run for short distances for up to 35 miles per hour. That's close to 60 clicks per hour. Or it can cruise along steadily at about 16 kilometers per hour, which is 10 miles per hour. Those black antennae-looking things on the top of the heads of giraffes are in fact radio transmitters that have been installed by innovative African telecommunications companies to use the tall animals as ambulatory cellular phone towers, which is why African cellular phone service is way better than what we have here in North America. Okay, although African cell service is better and cheaper than in North America, the organs are actually called ossicones, and the males use them for sparring.
The elephant's strange, I'd say, overall. Its legs are like pillars that form a great hall. Its sides like the daub on a huge mudded wall. Its tail's like a rope, but don't climb up, you'll fall. Its trunk's like a snake, or maybe a tentacle. Spear-like its tusks, its ear fan so bendable. Like some magic beast conjured with spell and pentacle. But don't give her a bike, she'll just make it a bensicle.
Well, I just love elephants.
One of the things I like is that their matriarchal societies tend to not be so much based on aggression as, say, that of hyenas. The bull males generally live solitary lives, except when they come together to fight with each other, whereas the females and the young live together in familial groups, which generally are headed by an aged matriarch. Her experience in locating seasonally available food and water resources seems to be as important as aggression in establishing her dominance. There are many observed instances of altruism amongst elephants, and I can only imagine that this individual, who has lost a significant portion of her trunk, possibly due to a crocodile attack or getting caught in a poacher's snare, must have been assisted by herd members during what must have been a lengthy healing process. And as you can see, she seems to have been able to attain a position as leader in the group. Another favorite animal of most people is the rhinoceros. These white rhinos consume about 54 kilograms of grass per day, compared to about 68 kilograms of vegetation consumed by hippos, as compared to about 100 to 300 kilograms per day of various types of vegetation consumed by elephants. As might be expected, this generates a lot of manure. Interestingly, rhinos tend to defecate in the same location regularly, which are called middens, and the males monitor the fertility status of the female from the odors in their droppings. You'll notice that this group consists of three rhinoceri, a male accompanied by two females, one of whom has not yet reached full sexual maturity. While yet again on the topic of mating, here's a joke that I wrote. What do you get when you cross a rhino with an elephant? The elephino! I found out a bunch of other people also invented that same joke. By the way, these videos were not taken in Murchison Park, but were instead taken at the Ziwa Rhino Preserve, which is a couple hours away. In the company of the park guards, whose duties are largely to keep people away from the rhinos as much as the rhinos away from people, we were able to get relatively close, as you'll be able to see. This would not be the case if these were black rhinos, which are much less tolerant of disturbances. In fact, if you've ever seen the movie The Gods Must Be Crazy, and do you remember the scene in which the rhino was seen pounding out flames with its feet, that's like a real thing. Black rhinos are very territorial and intolerant of anything out of the ordinary in their space, and have been observed, therefore, to trample out small bushfires. The rhino's horn, from which it derives its name, rhinoceros, meaning nose horn, is made out of keratin, the same protein that covers the sheaths of antelope and other bovid horns, and is the same material from which human hair is made. In some cultures, it is believed that ingesting the ground horn of rhinos will improve the sexual performance or size of men who have failing or very tiny wieners. There is no validity to this, and men with small wieners would do just as well ingesting sweepings from barbershop floors. So spread the word and help save rhinos from poaching. Men who ingest rhino horns have small wieners, and it's not going to do them any good anyway. Here's another little ditty to help you remember. Only men who have wieners excessively tiny would think things improve taking horn of the rhiny. Try some Viagra to get up your bone. Rhinos won't do it, so leave them alone. The cattle egret seen here will often accompany large ungulates such as rhinos and elephants, and we saw them in some of the other videos with the Ugandan cob. And the birds will consume insects and other small animals that are flushed out as the ungulates graze. The cattle egret, much like the African oxpecker, will go so far as to remove ticks from the skin of its ungulate companions. The white rhino is so called not because of its color, but rather it is a corruption of the Afrikaner term for wide, referring to the animal's lip, which is wide and squarish for browsing on grass, as opposed to the black rhino's pointed and more or less prehensile lips, which are adapted to browsing on thorny branches. In the background there, you might have noticed a couple of guys, Gabriel and his brother Vincent from Quebec, and Alex, with whom I was touring for a couple of days, and Willie, our Ugandan guide and guard. And that dork there, that'd be me. Hope you enjoyed the video. Hope you learned some things. Go tour Africa. It's great. Thanks. Bye.